Welcome to Chapter 5, Database Processing. We're starting to get into more technically challenging material. And I'm going to record a supplemental video for your studying of this topic. As you go through and make sure to continue reading the book, you will be having an midterm coming up soon. And you will want to make sure that you've been reading the chapters as we go. All right, so purpose of a database. I know that oftentimes I hear Excel quoted as a database when it actually is a spreadsheet application. It can have multiple spreadsheets within a workbook, but a database is different in many respects. Typically, data that's stored for large businesses, you're going to find that it's inserted into a database versus into a spreadsheet. Spreadsheets are more of a small-scale way of manipulating database or data, where a database is a much larger scale. And there are different types of personal and enterprise databases, but we'll get to that in a little bit. So why use a database? Well, the data has the benefit of providing greater insight into whatever your organization is doing. And the collection of that data allows employees to better understand their market, and depending on your organization and what you're doing, help understand the customer. And the more data that you can collect, typically the better. A spreadsheet allows you to manipulate data, but the underlying process of collecting that data is not necessarily present. Okay, understanding databases. Databases consist of tables, relationships, metadata. Tables are a collection of related records. So you may have multiple tables that are tied together based on related information. For instance, you as a person will have multiple tables tied together by your social security number. So there's one social security number for each individual, and then you may have multiple related tables out there, whether it be by government or other organizations that have access to your social. Metadata provides, relationships allow a table to tie together based on key fields. As I was just describing, metadata provides helpful information regarding the fields in a database. So essentially, this allows the end user to be able to look at the field name, and a database administrator, if they don't know what they're doing, may have described a field or labeled a field by an acronym that somebody may not understand. And sometimes this is done to keep things simple, but in the description field or in the metadata, they can provide a better understanding or clarity as to what is contained within that field. So why do databases require database administrators to define data field types? When you're creating a database, unlike an Excel spreadsheet, you can just start typing in text within a cell, and later you can come back and you can format it. In a database, you're going to create each field and you're going to assign it a data type. And the reason for doing this is to retain data integrity. So if you were trying to manipulate data and you hadn't defined that a field was a date field, somebody could have, for instance, typed in February the 30th, 2014. Well, February 30th does not exist, And so you would have issues with data integrity. Numeric values, for instance, if you're putting in a social security number, there's really no reason to make it numeric because you're not going to be performing any math operations on that. Same thing for a text. You wouldn't want to make a numeric field text if you plan on performing operations on it. And some of these can be converted and manipulated still, but in good database design, you want to be very careful in your development to develop it correctly. A yes-no a Boolean values, that would be the same as, for instance, a checkbox or something that's true-false. It's either going to be one or the other. And this is one of the smallest database entities. And the reason that that matters is because databases can have millions and millions of records. And when you start talking about that amount of data, a good database design will help minimize the size of those databases and keep it from mushrooming into something that's out of control and difficult to manipulate or difficult to extract data from. So a database administrator's responsibility is to be concise with the data that they're developing a table for. Auto number is another data type, and typically an auto number it is something that can be used for a key field. So it gives a unique identifier to each entry within that table. There are several others, and some of these data types vary depending on the data application that you're using, from Microsoft Excel to a more corporate environment, Oracle or DB2 or some other database management system. Relational databases, you may hear me from time to time mention relational databases, and what essentially that is saying is that in order to extract data from a database, typically things are broken down into relational tables or tables that are related on key values so that they can tie together. I gave a social security example earlier, but let's say that your student data, and most colleges now are getting away from using social just for HIPAA reasons, and FERPA reasons. So if we have a UIN or a universal identifier, or in our case, I believe we call it a campus-wide ID, attached to each student, then when you go to financial aid, they may have tables that are strictly financial aid related. However, your personal information may be in a completely separate table, but they're linked together based on that CWID. So there's a relationship between those tables that is established by that ID, so that data can be tied together. And then you may have in the registrar's office, you may have a course schedule. And from that CWID, then a course schedule can be looked up in a separate course table that has a list of all the courses. You may have a intermediate table that just consists of your ID and course IDs. And those two tables are related through that table. And again, it can be linked to grades and so forth. So relationships are the string that ties these tables together so that you can get to data and be able to manipulate it. Without those relationships, then you have no way of accessing that information. So if you didn't have the relationship between the campus-wide ID from your student data to your financial information or financial aid information, then you would either be duplicating information by keeping all the personal data in multiple locations, and that would be bad design, because if, for instance, you got married and your last name changed, then it's got to be updated in each database or each entity of that data. So that's poor data design. You want to relate them together in the most efficient way possible. All right, database processing. The book gives a different list, but I like to use the CRUD principle. I create, read, update, delete. It's standard through pretty much all programming or database processing. You're doing one of those things. You're either creating, you're reading, you're updating, or you're deleting. I just find that the CRUD is easier to remember than what the book provided. SQL, also you'll hear SQL. It's a structured query language. It's a very wordy language. When you see SQL queries or SQL queries, a lot of times you can look at them and interpret what they're trying to do or the data that they're trying to get out just by looking at the SQL statement. Unlike some programming languages where it's very difficult to determine what's going on, SQL is a lot easier to read. For instance, a lot of basic commands would be select, insert, delete, join, update, values, set, distinct, different terms like that. So a very simple query that you see quite often is select, and I put the asterisk in there. We could say select all, but the asterisk is very common as kind of a short form, but select all from, and then the table name. That would select all the values so that you can manipulate it. Select column name two, from table name, where column name equals value, would be a slightly more complex statement. And basically, it's selecting two columns from a table where a column value actually equals whatever value we've set. Now, SQL statements can get very complex based on joins, and that's again applying those relationships to the data so that you can extract data from multiple locations to build the data set that you're after. When you visit a website and you log into it, a lot of times there are SQL commands operating in the background that will look up your user, will track your ID with the pages you visit. Google Analytics essentially has that going on in the background as you visit sites, and they're tracking that data and they're tying it together. On the reporting end, they're going to use SQL commands to pick up that information. So SQL is very common, and it's an operation that is going on in the background quite often as you browse the web, since so much on the web these days is a database is the back end to it. Everything Web 2.0 is essentially database driven. So the value of databases. You may have heard the term data is king. Some will say content is king, data is king. Data and data mining provides organizations with greater insight. You can make stronger business decisions, and we've been going over this as we go through some of the spreadsheet examples of how to take that data and try to make a business decision based on that data. Now that we're getting into databases, you're looking at it on a much larger scale. We're not looking at just a single spreadsheet that gives us a small glimpse of our operations, but we're looking at a mass amount of compiled data. And it can be a smaller amount as well, but typically you're looking at a more aggregate of a larger population of data that you're working with and trying to make decisions based on that information. But that amount of data does have a cost with it. When you're collecting millions and millions of records, when you're tracking what so many of your customers are doing and collecting this marketing data or information, you start to compile large amounts of database or data that has to be stored and manipulated in an efficient way. So there's going to be a cost as far as how you store it, how you manage it, how you manipulate it. There may be cost in bandwidth, in storage, in hardware, and cost in just people, in salaries, and in designing those databases, in licensing software, and licensing the software that allows you to generate reports. And there is a lot of cost to manipulating or storing and manipulating that data. But those that can make sense of the data have the advantage, and that's why it is so valuable. It doesn't make sense for a small, for instance, some of our examples, a small bike shop, necessarily to have a large database management system if it doesn't benefit them in a cost, or if it's just cost prohibitive to store that amount of data in a database management system, or to put the money into doing that. Now, for our large scale businesses, it does make a lot of sense. So these database management systems, when you hear me say a database management system, Access is a database management system, but that's a small scale. It's more of a personal database management system, versus a larger scale system might be, like I said earlier, Oracle or DB2, and it'll integrate with other systems. For instance, in the financial side, you'll hear PeopleSoft and how to manipulate that data and create forms and reports that are elegant for the end user, and allow end users to better interact with those systems. All right, to better understand relationships through or within a database, typically before creating that database, if you're trying to create a new database, you're going to have to create a entity relationship diagram. Or say you're going to have to. You don't have to, but you're going to wish you had. And the reason for that is that you're essentially creating a blueprint for that database. You don't have to create a blueprint before you start building something, but if you're building something complex and you don't have a blueprint, you usually end up paying the price for not creating that beforehand. So a graphical representation of a database relationship, also known as an ERD or entity relationship diagram, consists of five things: entity, attributes, primary key, relationships, and cardinality. And essentially, in this example here, you see a department advisor and a student, and you see what's called a crow's foot below. And this diagram is showing us that there is one department, and this slash here, and refer to your book for a little more information, but this is a one-to-many relationship is what it's telling us. So there will be one department that has many advisors, but each advisor may have many students, but many students will only have one advisor. So that's what that entity relationship is telling us. And those things will be tied together on primary keys, or there may be complex keys, and we won't go into that right now, but you have to have this structure to be able to tie tables together and be able to gather the information that you need. So I hope this supplemental video helps in understanding databases and how they interact, and the importance of them, and some of the cost to them as well.